Hello and welcome to episode 141 of Ready to Mosh. I'm Kev P, and alongside me is the winter to my passing. It's Gem G.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm hoping winter has passed. It doesn't feel like it much at the moment, does it?
No, it's very rainy at the moment. A rainy bank holiday Monday as we record this.
Yeah. Feels like we have like one day of nice weather and then 6 days of shite.
Yeah, that's pretty much what it is at the moment.
Mm.
Anyway, getting sidetracked again. But this episode is the Uprising Festival review.
It is, yeah. So we are going to talk about the night before Uprising on Friday night. And then moving on to the band that we saw on Saturday.
Mm.
And the changes to the layout and other such stuff.
Should we move on to the Friday then?
Yeah, we had a slightly harrowing driving to Leicester.
Well, you did. You were driving.
It seemed more harrowing than last year, but we were staying at a different hotel. So we went a different route, I think.
Yeah, it was a nice hotel, but it was almost in the belly of Leicester itself, wasn't it?
I don't know what you're going to say then. You're going to say the bell end of Leicester.
That's not what I was going to say.
Actually, we should probably just say at this point, we've spent about 6 hours trying to record this, but every time we tried, someone got either a mower or a strimmer out outside. So it's much later in the day that we're doing this than planned, and I think I'm starting to get a little bit of delirium.
Again, yeah.
Again. Anywho, we got to the hotel. It was fine.
Yeah, made our way down to the Firebug, where the first night was.
And our first ever trip to the Firebug.
It was, yeah.
I was really excited because I've heard so much about the venue. I love exploring a new venue, so.
And it's a cool setup as well.
Yeah, I think it's... I was trying to think, are there any other venues that we go, like small venues that we go to, that have like food as well as drink in the kind of the main area? You know, like Rescue Rooms has got the bar to the side.
Yeah.
And I know very occasionally they've done kind of a pop-up food thing, but generally it's just drinks, isn't it?
Another venue that does a similar thing.
With food.
Ooh.
Because the Hairy Dog doesn't do food.
The Sal.
Oh, the Sal does food. I always forget the Sal does food.
And I think Chameleons might have done it at some point.
Rest in peace.
Yeah.
Can't remember if they did or not.
Not sure. Anyway.
Anyway, so yeah, it was nice to not have to think, oh, where shall we go for food beforehand? Because we looked at the menu in advance and it suited our needs.
Yeah, and it was kind of like really good price and kind of just the right amount. So you're not kind of just so stodgy you can't move all night.
Yeah, I was going to say, they had a good choice of burgers and you can choose kind of your topping and then your size of side. And there's other little bits of add-ons as well. So, yeah, for what we wanted, it was perfect. And then you're not to think about getting from where you are to the venue.
Yeah.
Because you're there.
Yeah, really easy to find. And, yeah, really good kind of like layout. The drinking area is kind of like the normal bar areas downstairs. And there's a garden out the back, like a smoking garden, beer garden kind of thing, that's got quite a bit of decent coverage as well. So you're not always going to get soaked. And then the venue itself, which actually reminded me, I remember saying to you on the night, reminded me of Chameleons.
You thought that. It reminded me of the Orange Tree in Nottingham, which is not even called the Orange Tree anymore. It's called something else.
Yeah, I don't understand that because that's kind of like a big... Do you mean the back room?
Oh, sorry, I'm talking about downstairs. You're on about upstairs.
Yeah.
Sorry. Yeah, downstairs.
That makes complete sense, Sarah. I don't get what you're talking about.
Yeah, no, when we were downstairs, I said it reminds me of the Orange Tree, the kind of a lot of wood and plants and a very good cocktail menu, which we were very restrained and didn't try.
No, really wanted to.
Even though your favourite was on there.
No.
But we knew that we'd got a long day ahead of us on Saturday, but we're definitely going to go back.
Yeah.
When there's a gig on, we're going to keep an eye out for something that we can get to and also test the cocktail menu out. Yeah, the venue upstairs, it reminded me of the Sal again. I think it was the beam, the kind of pointy ceiling.
Okay.
Yeah. Reminded me of that, really.
Yeah, it was kind of, it was the shape of the room for me and pretty much the height of the stage that reminded me of how Chameleons used to be.
Yeah. Yeah, it was quite similar in that way as well. It was just the roof for me.
Yeah, so the room itself, it's quite a rectangular room and there's a small little bar to the back so you can grab a beer so you don't have to keep going downstairs.
Yeah, one thing I thought was interesting, actually, you're allowed to take your glasses upstairs.
Yeah, that was unusual.
Yeah.
I'm used to going into a venue and it's in plastic pint pots.
Maybe that says more about where we're from than
maybe, yeah.
I was thinking, because, yeah, between bands, we nipped down and got a pint, didn't we?
Yeah.
And you were like, are you going to down that in 10 minutes then?
Yeah.
Leave it with me. But no, they said I could take it upstairs.
Yeah, that surprised me. I can't think of any other venue where you can take a glass upstairs.
No.
Or into the venue itself.
Yeah, because even like at rescue rooms, if they know you're going next door.
Yeah, they'll ask you and then it's poured into plastic.
Yeah, and obviously Hairy Dog is all plastic. And other venues that are just like pure venues.
Yeah, they're always plastic.
Right then, first band.
Yeah, actually the only band that we've seen play before.
Yeah, and this was our third time seeing them.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, band we were very familiar with, which is Voidwalker.
I think we said on the preview episode, actually, we saw them won the Leicester Metal to the Masters final last year. And then saw them with their Bloodstock performance. We had a chat with Callum and Robin in the press area after they played last year at Bloodstock. And yeah, it was great to see them again.
Yeah, it was a really good performance. They do seem to just keep getting better and better and tighter as a band.
Yeah, definitely. It was good to see them in a smaller venue. I know obviously the Metal to the Masters final last year was smallish, but this was like a lot smaller and we were a lot nearer the front.
Yeah.
So
you felt a bit more engaged as opposed to being in a bigger room where it maybe wasn't as intense, if that makes sense.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, room size, a lot more scale back. So it was good to get that kind of close-up view and you just really got fully washed by the sound, which is just so technical, so many different levels and layers to it.
Yeah, in my notes I've wrote, it's like the technical prowess is really coming through. And what I did like as well, for the first band on the Friday, there was a decent-sized crowd in.
Yeah, and obviously they're a local band, so they've got a lot of local support, haven't they?
Yeah.
But yeah, it was good to see that, because I know that we've been to gigs and the first band on have not had many people there.
Yeah, I mean, we've been in gigs where there's been like 12 people, and part of those 12 are going to perform later on.
That's true, yeah. So it was really good to see that.
Love the vocals, and like we were saying, the technical skills, and they're getting so tighter. And yeah, absolutely solid performance. Next up then were Akira, who we interviewed 2 episodes ago.
Well,
I did. Yeah.
Yeah, I was on my jollies.
Yeah, this was weird because I think obviously because Voidwalker had finished and everybody had gone out to get a drink or gone for a smoke or whatever. When they started back up again, I looked around and I thought, Jesus, not many people here for this. And then I kind of like turned around again a couple of minutes later and it was heaving.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It really soon started filling up.
Yeah, I think it was just that people probably hadn't realised.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it was Queen of Heaven they played as the second track. Absolutely love that.
Yeah, there was a couple of tracks that stood out for me. And I think it might have been maybe the third or fourth ones that they did.
Yeah, the third one was a new track.
Yeah, that was really good. And there was one off the album in particular that stood out for me. I can't remember which one it was. But it's like my favourite one off the album. Brain's gone.
but they got a really good reaction to the new track. And it felt a lot darker as well than some of the stuff from the first album.
Yeah.
Hell of a lot darker. The guitar work was incredible. And I remember talking to them after the set as well. And I said to Ginger that after that second track that I really liked, I said, you looked exhausted after that. He said, oh no, I was fine after that. The third track killed me.
Yeah.
He says, because it's a new one and everybody's still trying to get it right. But they pulled it off. It sounded great. And they even got there's like a 15, 20 people all rowing on the floor.
Yeah, I think they said it at the start of the track, didn't they? They did it to like get a rope it going and nobody did, but then it kind of got to the middle and people got down and other people joined in. And
that's it, as soon as one goes.
Yeah, but as per, I think the person next to us or a couple of people next to us said, too old for that. If I'm down, I'm not getting up again.
Yeah. Yeah, it's always a danger when you're our age.
Exactly.
I think that was the second to last track that happened on, but yeah, absolutely love the performance. Good to see them live and really looking forward to seeing them again, actually.
Yeah, I was really looking forward to them because I've loved what I've listened to so far from them.
Yeah.
I think they would do really well at Bloodstock as well.
Yeah, definitely. And I'm really looking forward to hearing the new stuff that they're working on.
And next up was one man death metal band. Can you call it a band when it's one person? A one man band?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the whole point, isn't it?
Yeah.
One man death metal band, Foul Body Autopsy, who I've wanted to see for ages and did not disappoint.
Yeah, I missed the first part of this because I was talking to Akira outside.
Well, yeah, I remember actually.
And it's a weird one with this because I thought his guitar playing skills were incredible.
Mm.
And I was trying to work out, is it harder, which I think it might be, to do what he's doing? Because although he's written all the music and, you know, done all the backing tracks, is it harder to play in time to what you've already written? Because there's going to be no mistakes in that. Mm. Whereas you could make a mistake and not restart.
That is true, yeah.
I mean, you've got nobody else to carry the weight.
Yeah, it's almost a bit like a karaoke kind of setup, isn't it? In the, obviously, you've got your backing track, which he's obviously done himself, and it's just the vocals and the guitar that's live. But yeah, it's because you've not got anyone on stage to kind of
support you,
yeah. Vibe with you, you know, and as occasionally happens, you might need to restart something or something's not right. And yeah, it's a weird one, isn't it?
Yeah.
But it works well.
Oh, yeah.
Our perspective, yeah. It did at least.
Yeah, the intensity and the noise. Jesus Christ.
Yeah, and I just love the plain kind of backdrop that he had with just the logo. And it was just so dark, and it looks really cool on the photos because it's just like his silhouette.
Yeah. Yeah, because there's hardly any lighting on him.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, I'm not here, just listen to the music.
Pretty much that. Or, yeah, almost like, you know, when you get someone behind the screen and you just see their shadow. It was a bit like that.
Yeah. And the interesting part about that as well is that he had kind of like a reserved kind of presence, if you know what I mean, and seemed like he didn't want to be the center of attention. But obviously, he is the center of attention. Yeah. And like you said, with the silhouette, I think that just works amazing. Yeah. That's a great idea.
I think the whole kind of atmosphere and ambiance, as it were, of his set was great. Different, but great, and definitely watch again.
Yeah. And then moving on to the headline band, which were a late, last minute replacement, weren't they?
Yeah, so in a change to what we said in our preview episode, I think around 2 days before the event, the original headliners, Hang the Bastards, withdrew.
Yeah. And they were replaced by Hidden Mothers.
And we knew absolutely nothing about them other than that they were from Sheffield.
Yeah.
Pretty much, because we didn't really have time to do more than that.
Yeah, that was it, yeah. But solid replacement, did an absolutely amazing job, and reminded me a little of kind of Badflower, I think, in places.
I remember you saying that, yeah. I didn't get that so much.
It was one of the vocalists who just kind of gave me that kind of feeling.
Mm.
And it was kind of, the look and sound just reminded me of Badflower, but obviously with the other bits, with the other vocals, it was like a very, very heavy version.
Yeah, there was very contrasting vocals, weren't they? But they kind of worked really well together. And I think one of their description on, I think it's Instagram, is it ethereal post-hardcore?
Yeah.
Which, yeah, definitely you get those ethereal vibes from, I want to say, the second vocalist or, you know, what I'm referring to, don't you? Yeah. I thought it was a really interesting sound.
It's a different mix, wasn't it?
Yeah, I wasn't quite sure what I was expecting, but I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, I mean, they stepped up, did an excellent job. And like we say, it was kind of like 2 days before the event started and they were kind of like drafted in. And yeah, absolutely solid performance again. And I think the whole selection of bands for the Friday, spot on.
It was kind of a varied selection, but in a good way, and very fitting for Uprising, which itself has a very varied.
Oh, yeah, it's got the complete mix.
Yeah.
That's what I enjoyed about the Friday. And because the tickets for Friday as well were really cheap, weren't they?
Yeah, I think they were about £11 with fees. Yeah.
You know, and but see, what was it, four bands?
Yeah.
You know, you can't complain about that, can you? That is just incredible pricing.
I think we said on the preview, if Hang the Bastards had have played, they were, again, very heavy. And we said, like, the Friday's looking like it's going to be a much heavier
set.
Overall, yeah. But I think having Hidden Mothers gave it more of a balance of different.
I think it actually worked out better.
In a way, because you had that onslaught of Foul Body Autopsy.
Yeah.
And then it was a lot more kind of heavy but chilled at the same time.
So that was the Friday, and it kind of like set us up well for Saturday. But like you said, it was good not to get kind of carried away, although we could have done.
Carried away with the cocktails.
Yeah.
Yeah, we could have stayed after for a nightcap, but we thought, we'll be sensible.
We'll be sensible tonight, yeah. Yeah, so we made our way back to the hotel and got a good night's sleep.
A nice breakfast.
A nice breakfast, yeah.
Set us up for the day.
Yeah, so then we'll move on to the Saturday.
So, yeah, we got to the O2 around about 10 to 12 because we knew that doors opened and the press room was open at 12. because there's been a few lineup changes, not lineup, layout changes even. So we knew that the press room was actually kind of within the main building this year, as opposed to last year where you went around the outside up to the student union. And I think we could get in there earlier last year. And yeah, we had a bit of fun again with security trying to get in the building, shall we say.
I don't know what it is about the O2, but it's like the whole team at Uprising, the whole press team, just absolutely incredible.
Yeah, the whole organisers of Uprising are amazing. So
it's not them, yeah.
Yeah, they were absolutely trying their best to help us and other press people get in the building.
And yeah, there were several kind of conversations between press team who were, you know, trying to explain to the security, these people have to bring their bag. The press room is in the building. They have to come into the building with their press bags because it's their bags to do their jobs.
Yeah, they need
their kit.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that was fun and games. That was kind of like, it was about 20 minutes or so, wasn't it? Just trying to...
We got quite a few steps in before we'd even got to the building, let's say. Because we had to kind of go back and forth initially to get our wristbands and our lanyards. Then we had to be escorted into the bit where we got the wristbands and the lanyards. And then, yeah, the main issue was that you're only allowed, I think, through maybe one or two doors with a bag in the O2.
Yeah.
Whereas last year, because we could go around the outside, we knew there was a line you couldn't cross with your bag, and that was fine.
Yeah. And then obviously everybody kind of taking kit either had to be, if you were doing interviews upstairs or outside somewhere, you had to be escorted around. And it all, I think security just kept getting mixed messages from different people at security, and it just turned into a bit of a mare for quite a few people.
Yeah, because I think we only had half the press room set up that we should have had in the first place, which didn't help.
No.
Fortunately, it was a nice day, and anyone who was doing interviews could use kind of the outside...
mezzanine.
Yeah, concourse type thing, which could be used last year. Not quite sure what would have happened there if it had have rained.
But yeah, that is not in any way, shape or form a reflection on Uprising organisers or the team, the press team, and anybody there, because they were all just unbelievably helpful.
Yeah, and we eventually got in the room, we put our stuff down, because there was a security outside the press room door, we kind of just had to make ourselves known to them.
Yeah.
So that they knew who to expect to be going down that corridor, basically, which was fine. So yeah, by the time we'd actually done all of that, we had about 5 minutes to get to watch the first band, the Masters final, because I had this whole idea in my head that while it was quiet, as part of the vlog, I'd do kind of a little walk through the whole building and show the layout and everything, and that just didn't happen.
No.
So I kind of tried my best throughout the day to show bits of that, but yeah, that all went...
a bit wrong.
Yes, to put it politely.
But we made it for the first band.
We did, which were a band that we had seen before, Running With Knives. They were in the Metal to the Masters final last year.
Yeah.
And it was good to see them back again.
Yeah, it was. And all of the bands, we've said this on multiple occasions on different episodes, but all of the bands again this year, top quality bands, any one of them could have won.
Yeah.
We'll tell you who won once we've gone through each band. These were my personal favourites of the day, and I really, really enjoyed their set again.
Yeah, they were my favourites as well, just because I think they were a bit more kind of to my taste as well.
Yeah, I think that's what it is. Yeah, so this was just a personal taste for me. It's like they do stuff that I actually really like.
Whereas last year, I kind of enjoyed all four of the bands, and I would have found it harder to pick. I think I would have had an easier time picking if I had to this year, just because of...
personal taste, Yeah, so again, with Running With Knives, there was some really decent support early on.
Yeah, which I remember from last year, a lot of people in their shirts, and they were there obviously early on because they were up first.
Yeah, it filled really quickly, and the opener was incredible. And I think the vocals for Running With Knives, there was just something about their music just kind of hit me more.
Yeah.
And I just seemed to enjoy it that little bit more.
Yeah, same for me. And you could definitely see an improvement in them from last year as well.
Yeah. Do you see that with all of the bands that come back in? You know, if you do get bands come back in final, you see all of their sets get so much tighter. And we said it about Voidwalker the night before.
Yeah.
And again, Running With Knives, exactly the same.
And then next up were Feral State, who are kind of a hardcore, punky, metalish band.
Yeah.
But yeah, these are really heavy, punky. I think they could, yeah, they kind of could fit in well at Bloodstock.
Mm.
They got the, I can't think who they reminded me of, actually. But yeah, just short, sharp shocks of songs.
Yeah.
As you get with that genre.
Yeah, they were much heavier and faster, and they had loads of energy.
Mm.
And it was also the first pit of the day.
Yes, it was, actually, yeah.
And unfortunately, there were also the first audio issues of the day.
Mm.
And I think that threw them a little bit slightly. But, you know, they kept battling through. They did a really good job. And like you say, could easily fit into Bloodstock. I think all of them could, to be honest.
Oh, yeah.
You can see why they've all kind of reached the final.
Yeah.
Next up were Independent Trucking, who are incredibly different than anything else that was in the Metal to the Masses. And I could listen to these all day.
Yeah, they're very different to probably anything I've seen live for a long time.
Yeah.
To be fair.
And it's just incredible guitar work. And I don't remember there being much vocally.
They weren't, they're all instrumental.
They're all instrumental, yeah. Aren't they?
Yeah.
And it was just good to see something different.
Yeah, and good that they've got that far as well, being different.
Being different, yeah.
Because there's always the danger that you do get a lot of same-sounding bands getting through, if you know what I mean,
yeah.
At that point.
So, yeah.
Yeah. But I wasn't that familiar with them before, probably least familiar with them. And I think we might have missed the first track. And we came in and I noticed there was no vocal. And I was like, oh, is it just like the end of a track or
yeah.
An interlude, if you will. And I just had a quick Google about them. And yeah, it's literally just instrumental, but very good instrumental.
Yeah. And how Feral State were kind of like a pit band.
Mm.
These were kind of more, you just kind of like engrossed by it. So yeah. It's not a pit band.
A head nod band, if you
that's, will. Well, that's exactly what I've got there. Yeah. And I think for complete overall kind of technical skill, possibly my favourite of the Metal to the Masses bands.
And I think as well, if you are just going to be pure instrumental, you have got to have
you
that
have
skill and
be really
talent good. Because there's no hiding behind a vocalist, is there?
No. And they absolutely nailed it. Like I said, I could listen to these all day, really like them, and will happily go and watch them again somewhere.
And then final of the four finalists were Break Them, another hardcore band.
Mm. Yeah, I could see why they made it that far. And they've kind of got the crowd on side.
Yeah, definitely.
There was a lot of pits opening up, a lot of crowd interaction. And it was kind of like the flip from what they were doing to what Independent Trucking were doing.
Mm,
so you got
yeah.
Two completely different things going off.
Yeah, definitely a very much of a contrast.
Yeah, I actually thought these would be the winners.
Yeah.
So although my personal pick was Running With Knives, I thought Break Them were probably going to win for the crowd interaction and the pits that were opening up.
Yeah, I know what you mean. They seem to have definitely that kind of crowd level. I don't know if that was just because they were last on, and obviously the crowd are a lot more warmed up.
And there's potentially more people.
And I kind of vaguely remember that being the case with the crowd from last year as well. But yeah, the overall, they were just, you know, brutal, heavy onslaught of sound. But yeah, say not quite to my taste because I'm not really into that hardcore sound as much, but definitely appreciated what they were doing. And what I thought was interesting as well was, I know the running order is like pulled out of a hat for the final, isn't it?
Yeah.
But I think it worked really well because I think if they'd have followed Feral State or vice versa, I think it would have almost merged a little bit. Not that they were overly similar, but same but different, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. And it would have thrown everything out, actually.
Yeah.
I think it was the perfect order.
It was, yeah.
And yeah, you're right. It would have, it just gave it a nicer balance.
Mm.
I think that's what it was.
So we actually missed the announcement of the winners because we were off watching another stage. But we can tell you that the winners were Running With Knives.
Yeah, well deserved. Send them a message. I texted them once we found out the result. Well, actually, not when we found out the result, but it was later in the day.
Mm.
And yeah, texted them to congratulate them. Yeah, very well deserved. Thought they were excellent. And I'm kind of glad that you know, I think everybody deserves recognition for getting that far anyway.
Mm.
And yeah, like I said, they were my favourites on the day. I didn't necessarily think they'd win, but they were my favourites of the Metal to the Masses bands.
Yeah, same. And I think just that level of improvement from last year to this as well.
I think it's putting in good state. You can see they've learned from last year and gone, okay, what can we do to improve on what we did? And they've gone and done it.
Yeah, they'll be seeing them at Bloodstock. They then started the festival proper And we had good intentions of trying to watch Bloodyard.
We did.
But again, due to kind of security and access issues, we had a bit of an issue finding Bloodyard.
We did, yeah. It was just, I couldn't get in my head how you got around there, because I couldn't, I mean, people obviously did. People obviously managed to get around there. We just didn't.
But we found it eventually and caught about the last couple of minutes.
Yeah, I think it was like a minute or two at the most, which was sad because I really wanted to see Bloodyard.
Yeah, I think out of all the bands on Academy 3, they were kind of the ones I wanted to watch the most.
And because all of the bands in 1 and 2 were back to back, it would have been nice to get between each three, but we couldn't really sort of do it to get a good understanding.
Yeah, it was quite difficult really, wasn't it, to do that, to get the right balance between the three stages.
Yeah.
So we just kind of focused on
1 and 2.
Yeah.
So first band that we saw on the main stage and open up the festival, I suppose the festival proper, and that was Mage. And yeah, I was really, really impressed with them. There were a couple of bits in it. It almost, you know, kind of like the bass in it reminded me of Chris Novoselic.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I got like hints of Nirvana. Just like there were certain bass lines. Were like, oh, that reminds me of something. I couldn't put my finger on it. I think it was Chris Novoselic.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, I was really looking forward to them. I've been listening to them quite a bit. And yeah, it was just good kind of bassy, stonery goodness, wasn't
yeah.
it? To kick off the main room, really. Yeah, I enjoyed the whole set.
Again, it was good because it's another band that I don't think we'd seen before.
No, I've not seen them before.
And it's another one that we can kind of add to a list and go, you know what, next time we get a chance to watch them, we'll go and watch them.
Yeah, because I can't remember if we said on the preview, I've seen them on quite a few kind of local-ish lineups and playing, you know, with similar kind of stonery bands.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'd definitely be looking out to see them again. And then we scooted through to Academy 2 to watch former guests who we had never seen live before and were promised chaos from. And that was Tribe of Ghosts.
Yeah, and they were also warned they had to kind of calm down.
Yeah, we had a chat with them after and, you know, they did say that they needed to not be quite their usual chaotic selves at the request of the venue.
Yeah, and they weren't chaotic in full force, but they were still chaotic.
Yeah, no blood was spilled.
No blood was spilled. No accidents. And yeah, incredible performance.
Yeah.
Absolutely loved it.
Amazing. Yeah, definitely lived up to everything that we hoped it would be.
Yeah, 100%. And finally, we've now ticked them off after trying so many times. And yeah, incredible set. Love the vocals, love the guitar work. One thing we also didn't realize, how big Danny is.
Yes. I don't know what, I think it's because he was sat down in the interview. Although Adam was as well.
Yeah.
A lot taller than I expected.
Well, the thing is, Danny also looks like a friend of mine who is a lot shorter.
Yeah, that's true.
But looks very similar.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, Christ, you're really, I mean, he towered over everyone.
Yeah, including you.
Including me, yeah. I'm like 6'1", 6'2", and he looked a lot taller than me. And yeah, so that threw me to start with.
Yeah.
But yeah, the performance, you can see why they did so well on the Sophie stage. They just lit it up, didn't they?
Yeah, you can see why they've got that reputation for their live performances.
Yeah.
And it absolutely, yeah, like lives up to it. And when we were speaking to them after as well, they did say that, I think they'd spoken to some people who had seen them before.
Yeah.
And they commented on how much better they were sounding because they have made a few tweaks to their kind of sound setup, haven't they?
Yeah.
And that. So in a way, it might be better that we waited till now to see them.
Yeah, I suppose, so. Potentially. And I think the work that they've done with those comments as well from people that have seen them before, it validates the work that they've been doing.
Yeah, and I can't wait to see them at their own show when they can unleash the absolute full chaos.
Yes, I'm definitely down for that. Next up then, a band we were very excited to see again, because we have seen them before, and previous guests, Seething and Akira.
Yes, I was so excited for this.
You and me both. And again, a set that didn't fail to deliver. Again, what did me with this was they got their backdrops on, which I was loving. But when we saw them at Bloodstock, we weren't right at the back, but you could kind of focus on the backdrops.
We had, yeah, like a more full distant view.
A full distant view.
Sometimes when you're closer up, you can't see everything as well.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, so if you're watching a show that has a lot of visual kind of accompaniments or it's part of a stage show, for instance, sometimes it's better to be further back.
Yeah, a bit like sitting too close to the front in the cinema.
Yeah. And with this, I was kind of, my eyes didn't know what to do because I was watching the performance and I was trying to watch screens. I was like, I want to see what mad shit they're throwing into the backdrops. But I don't want to, I'm like right at the front and I don't want to move.
Yeah, because I watched the first half or so, didn't I, from the pit?
Yeah.
And then I moved around a bit just so I could see a bit more of the screens.
Yeah.
As in from the photo pit, rather. Yeah.
Yeah, from the photo pit. Yeah.
Didn't get involved in no mosh pits. Gosh.
Yeah, they lit the main stage up, really. And it was a perfect follow-on from switching from to back to the main stage. Because that intensity of Tribe of Ghosts was there for Seething Akira as well.
Yeah, definitely followed on really well.
Yeah, so it was kind of like, it was genius to put Tribe of Ghosts, then Seething Akira, and being able to watch both and not miss a lot from either, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Absolutely amazing live, and people just have to go and check them out because words just don't do it justice. They are a band you have to see to experience it.
Yeah, I think if you've seen them, you know. And the crowd were just so into it. There's so much bouncing going off.
Yeah, it looked chaos behind me.
And for me, they played all my favourites. And we got two new tracks.
I think we did, yeah.
Yeah. No acoustic, sadly.
Yeah, no acoustics.
Two new tracks. Which are sounding awesome, so can't wait for the new album as well. And hopefully we'll get to see them again later in the year.
Mm-hmm.
So then it was back to Academy 2 and Ramage Inc. were on.
Yeah.
So we caught a little bit of them on our way to get food because we haven't eaten anything since our breakfast. And you know when you just know that you need to eat?
Yeah.
And have a bit of a sit down.
That's it. So this is getting kind of like 5:30, 6:00. We're not eating since 9, I think it was.
Thereabouts, yeah.
Yeah. So we needed some nutrients.
Yes. And yeah, what we saw of Ramage Inc., they sounded really good.
Yeah, very, very atmospheric, really loud. And I mean, I know saying really loud sounds a stupid thing to say about a gig, but it's more a wall of sound, isn't it?
I'd say it was a really full sound, wasn't it? All these different layers and different things that they got going on.
Yeah, so it's multiple things. It's not just guitars and drums. It's the way that it's layered, and it just adds something to it. So although obviously everybody works within the same decibel range, it just feels fuller.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
You know what I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hopefully the people know what you mean.
Yeah.
So yeah, we went to get food and we were very, very pleased to see that Wigston Deli, not just a corner shop, were there as they were last year.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
It's the one time of the year when you will fully, truly enjoy a vegetarian meal.
Correct, yeah.
That's not a cheese sandwich.
It's not a cheese sandwich or cheese on toast.
And as with last year, I think there was, you could either have a mix of three different items. Or you could just have the fully loaded bowl, which is what we went for. Because we was hungry. And it was it £9 or £9.50? I can't remember.
It was £9 for the fully loaded bowl.
Yeah, and it's an absolute bargain. And I feel like they should be at every festival.
Yeah.
I would happily eat that.
Think I would.
I think what you get in your bowl, you get a potato curry.
Yeah.
You get a proper good samosa.
Yeah.
A couple of barges.
Which were huge.
A potato bowl. Some kind of, was it maybe
it's a pakora, like I think. Big pakora, yeah.
And you get rice, and you get like a drizzle of green minty sauce as well. I think that was it. I've got a photo. Obviously, we'll share it.
Yeah, it was huge, and it was amazing.
And it was, yeah, it was just right. It was like filling, but not overfilling, although I couldn't quite manage all mine.
No, I made the mistake of finishing yours and just went, oh, I'm done now. I just need to lie down and sleep for a little while, but.
Yeah, and spice levels were just right for me.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. I mean, I like hotter food than you, but the spice levels were perfect because it's just loads of flavour.
Exactly. You don't want something too hot at a festival, do you? Really?
Not really.
No. But yeah, that's perfect nourishment for the day. It just suits the festival. I don't know why.
Yeah, it just does, doesn't it?
Maybe it's because we had it last year. We just associate it now, so we expect them there every year. And then there was one band that we didn't actually manage to see any of, unfortunately, due to our food and sit-down break, and that was Forlorn on the main stage.
Yeah, I think we pretty much watched everybody's set, or the majority of everybody's set, bar Forlorn.
Yeah, on Academy 1 and 2.
Yeah, which I'm sad about, but I will try and get to see them at some point.
Yeah, because I remember in the preview I was looking forward to them, but I'm sure we'll get a chance at some point. So next up then, all the way from Finland, were My Favourite Nemesis, who I was very much looking forward to because I've been enjoying listening to them beforehand. Did not disappoint. I had a good spot on the barrier for them.
Yeah, you were right down the front, weren't you?
I was, yeah.
Yeah, I was quite far back for this.
Yes, and what did you think of the Finnish band?
Really, really good. Great live performance. Just gave it everything.
Yeah, they had lots of energy. The twin vocals that they've got work really well, and they just come across really well live as well.
Yeah.
And they've got that, yeah.
A perfect slot as well, I think.
Mm.
You know, kind of like how we were saying about balancing the bands out and
yeah,
the slots that everybody played in, it just kind of made sense for them to sit there.
Mm. Yeah, definitely. They played a good selection of tracks. And yeah, it was just a really good performance. Just what I expected, really.
Mm.
You know, some bands that you listen to that you've not seen before, you're not quite sure how they come across live. But yeah, they were just really...
They matched your expectations.
Yeah. And another band I think that would be really good at Bloodstock. If they have not been before, I mean, maybe they have, I don't know. But yeah, I can see them on the Sophie stage. I think that would work really well.
Mm. Next up then, with a UK exclusive, Cellar Darling.
Yeah, and this all went a little bit wrong, didn't it? Bless them.
It did. Not their fault. There were a lot of they had a lot of technical issues. And, I mean, they kept trying to battle through it. They didn't play the whole set, I don't think. I think they only managed to get through about half of it.
I think, yeah, because... I remember coming straight from My Favourite Nemesis into the room, and they were still kind of doing some sound checks, and they kept trying different things. And I think they were supposed to do 7 till 7:45, and I don't think they really got going till about 20 past 7.
Yeah. And, you know, these things happen. I've seen so many things where it's not just on the day, it's just not gone right. And, you know, like how long were Metallica delayed in 2004?
Yeah.
You know, the headliner was delayed by over, was it an hour and a half or something?
Something
it was ridiculous,
like that.
Yeah.
But she did say, though, apparently they used to be, was it a band of 10 members with 30-odd instruments? And they've pared it down a bit these days. Yeah. There's not so many of either. But they'd flown over from Switzerland. They didn't have their full kind of set up.
Yeah.
And they do have some quirky, different instruments. I've never seen a flute at a melody before.
I reckon I might have done, yeah.
Have you seen a flute?
I'm trying to think. I'm sure I have. Anyway.
You've seen a cello? Who was that support band that had a cello at Rock City?
Oh, it was whoever... they supported Killing Joke.
Yeah. And not a ukulele, a mandolin?
It was either a mandolin or a sitar.
It was a sitar. Yeah, so anyway.
Again, off on a random tangent.
I was trying to think, have we seen a flute?
I think they might have had one as well, you know.
I think, that's a weird fuzzy memory.
Yeah.
But, anywho, what they did play sounded really good, and I was really looking forward to them because they were, I knew they were going to be different. And
yeah.
I think we said in the preview they're a bit like Seoul were last year.
Yeah.
In that same slot, I think. Yeah. So,
yeah. And it was almost going to be like a, I suppose, like a, almost like a palate cleanser of people to kind of, well.
That was exactly what I was thinking. Oh, right. Yeah, thinking like a lemon sorbet.
Yeah, but it's just something that you just become transfixed by. Like once they're able to start playing properly, vocally, unbelievable.
Yeah.
And so talented.
I was going to say this, like the mix of instruments and then that vocal over the top was stunning. So yeah, it was really sad that they couldn't do the set. They did say, however, that they're planning to come back to do a UK tour. And if you were there, you can message them with a certain something to say and you can get put on the guest list. Obviously, we're not going to say that because... You had to be there.
You had to be there, yeah.
But yeah, if they're going to come back to the UK, then...
I really want to watch them.
I'd really like to see a full set from
full
them.
Full show, yeah. Mm. And it's one of those things, can't be helped. It happens. I don't think I've ever been to any festival where something's not gone smooth all weekend.
Yeah, and they dealt with it really well, didn't they?
Yeah, they did absolutely everything they could.
Yeah.
And from when they were able to play up until they finished, I enjoyed every moment.
Yeah. And the next band on Academy 2 were a band that have actually just been announced to play the Courtyard at Download.
Yes.
Didn't they? And of all the comments on the lineup announcement, a lot of people are saying Lestel are really good. We're really excited that they're on there.
Mm.
So that kind of made me more excited to see them. And yeah, they did not disappoint. They just put on a really good, solid performance. And the room was quite empty when I went in, actually. I was surprised.
I was going to say that to you, that it was surprisingly quiet when I first went in.
Whether it's because they kind of, were they clashed with, who was on Academy 3, had a Borstal or Discharge at that point, potentially?
Would it have been Borstal, I think, at that time.
Yeah, they were at the same time as Borstal, so that might have impacted their audience, potentially.
Yeah, because, well, we said that Borstal are kind of like a supergroup.
Mm.
So I can understand why the crowd would be split there, but also people potentially trying to get a better spot for Progeria.
Yeah, that could have impacted too.
So there was kind of a few things going off at very similar times, or one after another.
Mm.
And I wonder if that maybe caused part of it. It did get busier.
Yeah.
It definitely filled up.
You see that a lot, actually, don't you? Kind of the crowd size kind of ebbs and flows. Because I think just because of the way that the lineup sit.
Yeah. And people watching one thing and maybe wanting to see like 20 minutes one, 20 minutes another. And fully understand that. But yeah, not to detract away from their performance because they were outstanding.
Yeah, I really enjoyed them. And I was looking forward to seeing a singing drummer, and his clean vocals are amazing.
Very.
How he does that on drums, we'll never know.
I still can't figure it out.
No.
Yeah, mind blow.
And again, one of those bands that just kind of transfixes you with that kind of just all the different layers of sound that they've got going on. It's like a big wall of sound. And yeah, very much enjoyed and looking forward to hopefully seeing them again in a couple of weeks. And it was at this point we realised we needed caffeine.
Yes.
Where do you go Uprising when you need caffeine? You go and see Phil at Motley Brew.
You do. Yeah, had a lovely cuppa and some flapjack.
Yeah, we got some free vegan flapjack, which made me laugh because very often if you get offered something vegan, you'll turn your snoot up at it.
Don't know what you mean.
So you had vegetarian tea and you had some vegan pudding.
I did have a full English with black pudding and everything else at the start of the day.
Yeah.
So I'd say balanced.
Yeah. Anyway, yeah, I had a lovely cuppa.
Yeah, very much needed. Just kind of a bit of a caffeine fix. And then I think I started on shorts.
Mm. Do you know what actually confused me this year as well? It was a similar time to when we had a coffee last year.
Yes.
We had it. We were having a coffee outside before Combi Christ. And my brain just was really confused because I remember it being dark at that point in time. Because obviously it was at the end of April last year.
Yeah.
And I couldn't get my head around
why
it was still daylight. It was really muddling me, throwing me off.
Just before we talk about this as well, one of the things I wanted to say, I don't know, you might be drinking, I think you were drinking different things to me, but the cider in Academy 2 was a million times better than Academy 1.
I remember you saying that. I was drinking the Spanish lager with the man in the hat on.
Madry.
Yes.
That's a sign that I drink way too much. It's the one with the man with the hat on.
That's the one.
It'd be mad, really.
Yeah, for some reason, the sun was out, so I fancied lager. And I had one hooch this year, as opposed to just drinking hooch all day last year.
Yeah, the cider in Academy 1 tastes absolutely disgusting. But in Academy 2, it's lovely. And it's the same drink. It was Thatcher's.
Mm. I'd say Dodgy Pipes myself.
I'm beginning to think that, because it didn't matter which bar you went to either.
Yeah.
Well, which as in pump. Which pump you were at. Yeah. All of them were just horrid from Academy 1.
It's either a dodgy barrel or some unclean pipes.
Well, there were different times of the day, weren't they, if you think about it. So it wouldn't be the barrels.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah, a complete aside from what we're going to talk about, but I only said it because I remembered that I went on shorts and I thought, oh, the ciders.
Being your pipes at O2.
Yeah.
My hooch was nice then. Yeah, so Brocheria were up next.
Yeah.
And oh, they were a bit good.
A bit good. That's the best review of it. They were a bit good.
A bit good, yeah. Yeah, again, it's a band. I think I kind of knew what to expect from them because they've been around so long that we haven't seen them before.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've seen some clips of them and they just are, they're just insane presence on stage, just the whole stage set up. The amount of people, there just seem to be a lot of people on that stage. Obviously, they all have the scars around their mouths. They look quite menacing from a distance.
It was quite near the back. Aggressive, isn't it?
Because the room was quite full when I went in and I thought, I could see the pit bouncing. I'm like, well, I'll have a distant view because I've been quite close to the front for most bands. So it was quite nice, actually, just to see the full room.
Yeah, and I was on the balcony.
At 2 o'clock?
Yes, at
2 o'clock. Positioning, not tight, it's not gone back inside.
Yeah, I'm not Marty McFly. Yeah, so I was on the balcony watching it and kind of getting a top, almost like a top-down view. To kind of like to the right-hand side. And yeah, I could see you at the back. And like you said, it was just non-stop. It was absolute bedlam.
Yeah. And again, what I loved about them, what I love about bands that have got, you know, kind of grindcore things going on. Short songs, less time in the air if you want to film one. You get a whole song really easily and you don't feel like your arm's going to fall off. Yeah. All songs should be less than 90 seconds.
Is that your opinion?
Yeah.
Okay. But yeah, again, another choice who absolutely can't smash the main stage.
Yeah, absolutely. Just a complete onslaught from start to finish. And what can you say? And then there were two headliners left. I think it's safe to say that there was one that you were more excited about and one that I was more excited about. But we were both looking forward to both.
We both wanted to see both. Yeah, we love both.
I think of the two.
Of the two, this was my band.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I was really looking forward to seeing them as well. Because as we said on the preview, I think when we interviewed them, I missed them in 2004 because I was stuck in the queue to get in.
Yeah. I watched them. They blew me away then. And they did it even more this time.
I mean, I don't know why we haven't seen them since before. Obviously, not well, the last 11 years.
11-year hiatus.
No, I meant between 2004 and when they went on their hiatus. I don't know why we haven't seen them.
Because, well, the tours weren't that frequent after a point.
I suppose. Anyway, we've seen them now.
You've seen them now. I've seen them twice. I've
ticked them off. And for a band who've had that 10-year gap, it doesn't show at all.
Oh, God, no. Do you know what? I thought that. So we were very lucky in, because we got press, we were very lucky in that where we could stand to watch this. And so we were kind of stood to the side of the photo area.
Yeah, basically side of the stage. And because of the way, and kind of in two stages, you can see through.
Yeah, you can kind of just see through the edge.
Yeah.
Edge of the stage. And yeah, so we saw them come on and the room just erupted. Everybody. Yeah. And I've got some pictures as well. I'll have to send all my stuff over to you. But I've got some pictures and you can see the amount. It's just a sea of people. It is insane.
Yeah, I think I tried to get some footage as well of like the whole room was bouncing from literally the barrier to the doors.
Yeah. And it was from the first song right till the end.
Yeah, there was just so much excitement to see them.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people would have been in a similar position to you in that they'd seen them before and they've just been waiting for this comeback.
Yeah.
And you could tell by the comments beforehand on their posts that they've been sharing. It was just
how much people wanted to see them. Yeah.
And I think if you spoke to people, so I chatted to a couple of people I know from Rockfit, spoke to them beforehand, like, who are you looking forward to? Everyone was looking forward to seeing them.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'll be honest, the main stage headliner was incredible, but I think Breed could have headlined main stage as well.
We could have, because
they were that popular with everybody. And I remember Simon was stood next to us.
Yeah.
And I just looked at him and went, this is an inspired choice. And you could see how kind of happy he was that Breed were doing it. And just the reaction of everybody else. And I absolutely loved this.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I know the very, very experienced musicians. I know they're very talented. But when you've had a break for so long, to just come back and go, it's like we did this yesterday.
Yeah. Like I said, you could not tell that they'd had that break. And I know that some of them have still been playing and et cetera, but as a band together.
But it's different, isn't it? Yeah. And it's like all of that magic was still there.
Yeah.
And from the moment they started. And yeah, the whole place just went absolutely insane. They rattled off some absolute classics. And they treated us to a new single that was released, well, today as we're recording.
Yeah, so at the event, it hadn't been released
yet. Yeah, it was unheard. And yeah, absolutely incredible. Loved it to bits. And I'm really looking forward to seeing what else they do.
Yes, definitely. And towards the end, watched the last couple of tracks from the back of the room.
Yeah.
To make our way through to main stage. And I think it thinned out a very tiny bit. Again, people might have been doing the same, or people might have gone to watch Discharge because they literally were back to back with them. But the room was still full and still buzzing at the end.
And when they finished, the roar that went up from everybody, it just, the whole place just exploded for these.
And then onto the main stage headliners.
And the one you were most looking forward to seeing, Catatonia.
Yes.
So you've had your little whoop, didn't you?
I had my little squee.
Yeah.
It was a squee when they were announced. Finally seen them.
Yeah. And I could just, you were transfixed.
They are a very transfixing band in a similar way to how Tool are, aren't they?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not a huge Tool fan, but watching them live, you do just get transfixed.
Yeah.
It's a very kind of...
It's absorbing.
Absorbing. It's a simple performance. There have been loads of bands throughout the day who had obviously fancy backdrops, and that's all great, and I love that. But it was just literally their logos on the screens, very plain stage, not over the top with the lighting or anything.
No, but just delivering.
Yeah.
And delivering consistently.
Yeah.
And yeah, you can see why they headlined, you know.
Yeah, again, a great choice.
Yeah. And I think that about all of the bands, because there have been, you know, obviously Breed are always going to be the band that I was most excited about. But Catatonia, I was so pleased to see them. And they played all of the stuff that I wanted to hear.
Same. It was like a greatest hits set, but they could do so many different greatest hits sets because they've got such a back catalogue, but it's like they tailored it for me.
I was exactly the same. Yeah, that's how it felt for me. It was kind of like greatest hits, but tailored. And they played everything that you kind of, you know, when you go to watch a band and we've done it before where we've been to see a band and who have got kind of like such a rich back catalogue and you're on your way home and you're going, oh, they didn't play that. Oh, I really wanted to hear that.
Yeah.
But with this, it was kind of like, we've picked these songs and they picked them so well because it was kind of like, that's what I wanted to hear.
Yeah.
And it's what you wanted to hear.
Yeah, very much so. And yeah, they had a standing guitarist, Millie Evans, because Anders hasn't been playing with them all year, I don't think, for personal reasons. So I know other gigs that they've done earlier in the year, they had someone else in, I can't remember who now. I think it was someone from Entombed or Enslaved. Anyway,
sure.
But yeah, they got Millie Evans on guitar and did an excellent job.
Yeah, really good stand-in. You can see why that draft was made.
Jonas's vocals are still perfect.
Yeah, you know, I noticed that.
We've said before, when it's a band that's been around for a long time, it can be that, you know, the vocalist is the most obvious thing to not work as well anymore.
Yeah.
Obviously.
But we've seen that happen with bands, and there are bands that we want to go and see again, but we kind of don't want to because the last time we saw them was that good.
Yeah.
With these, it's kind of like, well, we've got to see them this time.
Yeah.
And yeah, the vocals were spot on. Mm. It's like nothing had changed.
Yeah. Yeah, it was just a perfect set for me. And I loved as well that Jonas was just, he seemed to be obsessed with saying Leicester. You know, sometimes you get bands that like to say the place name. He said Leicester a lot. Yeah. Just kept making me chuckle.
One of the other things that I found quite funny, he was doing the running commentary on the Sweden-Denmark.
Oh, we mentioned the ice hockey.
Ice hockey, yeah.
Yeah. Well, we mentioned that they'd lost, hadn't they, Sweden, but yeah, he didn't seem that bothered. The other thing that made me laugh as well was, I think for about the last five tracks, he just kept saying, yeah, we've got a couple more. And they did go over their set time.
Yeah.
And I could see kind of the last track, people were kind of loitering at the edge of the stage, thinking, are they going to go? Wait, stop. Not by long, only about 5 minutes, wasn't it? But yeah. Yeah, it was just a captivating end. And a perfect end, I think, really.
Yeah, it kind of not wound the night down. It kind of just rounded it off and just balanced it beautifully. Again, like we've said about the whole of this, both the Friday and Saturday, it was just so well-rounded. And, you know, you'll watch one band and you will go and watch somebody else and it will be very different. And I think that's what works about this place.
And as per conversation we had with Simon Yard the night before, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
What we think works about Uprising, and a lot of people agree, is you've got that variety. You don't need to necessarily focus on one genre.
You don't need all thrash metal on one stage. You don't need all death metal on another. The way that he's getting these bands and the bands that he's putting on are just so well thought out and well balanced, and they complement each other in different ways. And it works.
Yeah,
and absolutely works.
It attracts that variety of crowd as well. And it's great that you do get events that are like a pure thrash metal, death metal, black metal, whatever, but this just works.
Yeah, but it works. And, you know, and it's the age ranges. Because there is a huge age range. You know, like, I'm not a young man anymore. And there's a lot of bands that I'm really excited about. But obviously, there's newer bands that I'm excited about as well. And then you've got people who are really young in comparison.
Mm.
And they're as excited about the older bands as they are about the newer bands.
Yeah.
And I think it just brings everybody together and everybody just wants to have a great time.
Mm. Yes. Well summed up. We've not mentioned merch. Do you want to just mention anything about merch?
Oh, yeah.
We went in with full intention of buying a lot of merch. We did buy a bit. I didn't get as much as I'd hoped.
I didn't either.
But first up, we did get our pre-ordered Uprising shirts.
Yes, they were waiting for us and love the design. And what you spotted that I'd missed to start with.
The Metal to the Masses bands are on them.
Yeah, so they must have printed, like you said, they must have printed them really, really close to the event starting. And the fact they've got them on, I think that's amazing because I don't know any other place that's done that.
No.
It will just say Metal to the Masses final.
Yeah.
But like they had all of the bands listed and it's kind of like, it's there. It's like, you know, you can see it.
Yeah, even obviously the band that won will have their name printed on a Bloodstock shirt, but it means all the finalists get theirs imprinted on the Uprising shirt.
Yeah, exactly.
And also another thing we love about Uprising is that if you pre-ordered your shirts, they were only £15.
Yeah.
Which in itself is a bargain. And then on the day, they're 20, which is also very much a bargain.
Yeah.
And I think we bought them on the day last year. And I think we said then it was a bargain.
We did, yeah. But then we said this year we're going to make sure we've got them because we've been so many places where they've just sold out completely. Yeah. So we were like, right, we need the T-shirts. So we're going to pick the T-shirts up. And while we were there, you picked the poster up.
Poster, because we got a poster last year. So I thought, you know. We'll get another one. But yeah, they were really encouraging people to pre-order their T-shirts anyway, because it helps them out as well. They're not wasting different sizes that obviously there's usually a certain size that sells out quicker than
It's usually mine.
Yeah, I know. But I mean, they get a rough idea of people who definitely want it. They can get that many done and then any leftover.
It's a bonus, yeah. And I also bought a Tribe of Ghosts T-shirt.
Yeah.
I bought a Seething Akira T-shirt. You got a Seething Akira t-shirt.
I did, and I would have got a Tribe of Ghosts one, but they'd sold out in my size.
Yeah.
But I'm intending to buy one when they have restocked online, which they said they will be doing. I was intending to buy a Catatonia t-shirt, but they only seemed to have one with them, and I didn't particularly care for it.
Oh.
It was just grey, and it had, like, their current logo on it, and...
The three... Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm going to buy a Catatonia t-shirt, because they've got loads on their merch site, and they've got a UK-based supplier, whatever.
It could have just been logistics.
I was going to say maybe it was just logistics because it's not like they're on a full-on tour, is it, at the moment? So, yeah, I will be getting one at some point.
Yeah, I also tried to get a Breed 77 t-shirt and they were only taking cash and that just destroyed me because it's like I don't carry cash that much anymore.
No, and it was pretty late in the day at that point, wasn't it? They just played, hadn't they?
Yeah, they just played. We were on our way back to the press area.
There may be a cash machine in the O2, I don't know, on the entrance perhaps. I think there were times when some bands were cash only, I think like when they were sound checking or something, like they'd got someone to take cash for them or whatever, but most of the other ones.
Yeah, because I was worried I wasn't going to get a Tribe of Ghosts t-shirt because I tried about three times and they just weren't around.
And also, just to say with the layout as well, so Academy 3 was upstairs in the student union, which I don't know if we actually mentioned, apart from the fact we couldn't find it to start with.
Yeah.
Having the merch where Academy 3 was last year in that longer room worked so much better because it was quite squashed in at the start, wasn't it?
It was,
at the kind of main entrance last year. And it just gave bands more space to actually be there and be on their merch stands and get to meet people and
talk to people.
Yeah, and some were there all day. Some obviously just had their merch there till they needed to leave or pack up or whatever. And I think that was really good. A good kind of communal thoroughfare between the stages as well.
It probably worked out better for them in sales, I would have thought.
Yeah, because Tribe of Ghosts said they'd pretty much sold out of everything and they'd still got a gig to do the night after. So
yeah, we are very, very much looking forward to Uprising 8 next year now.
Which will be on the same weekend.
Yes. I think that's already been confirmed, hasn't it?
Yeah, it was announced after Catatonia had finished playing. So that'll be Saturday the 24th of May next year.
Yep. One final thing we should mention as well. There was also, if you listen to the preview episode, there was also a third night, which we couldn't sadly do. But yeah, there was another four bands on Sunday, and that was at the O2 again.
So yeah, as we mentioned on the preview, it was Offness, The Infernal Sea, Ghosts of Atlantis, and Arcona, which was an absolutely great lineup, and we were very sad we couldn't stay around for that one.
Yeah, I spoke to a couple of people who were saying they were really looking forward to the Sunday night, who were staying for that as well. And yeah, it would have been nice to stay for that. Sadly, we couldn't make it. You never know. Hopefully we can do 3 days next time. And yeah, it was an absolutely, the whole weekend for me was just incredible. So I think to have a third night thrown in too. And the tickets for that were £20 in advance. And again, you're getting a great selection of bands.
Yeah, so all in all, it was a wonderful weekend, the days that we were able to go to. So just a few thank yous.
Yeah, a lot of big thank yous. Simon Yarwood for organising, putting on the event, because it's epic.
Yeah.
It really is.
And obviously, without him, there wouldn't be an event. So, yeah. Obviously, a big thank you to Dan at DC Sound Attack for inviting us along again and giving us the press tickets.
Yeah. Red, who was just... took no shit all day. She was epic.
Yeah, and without her, we'd probably still be wandering around outside.
Yeah.
We wouldn't have got in the building. So big shout out to Red and also to Emily for looking after us during the day at various points.
Absolutely wonderful, yeah.
Sorting our wristbands out and lanyards and again, yeah, just helping us out.
Yeah, all of the team just absolutely incredible.
See you next year. But yeah, that concludes our Uprising review. We've already put some pictures out on Instagram and the usual kind of places so far, a few little bits and bobs. Obviously posted some live bits during the day anyway, but if you want to check those out, we're at Ready to Mosh Cast on Instagram, Twitter or X, and Threads, Ready to Mosh on Facebook, TikTok and YouTube. We have got a vlog that will be out at some point very soon, hopefully. It is primarily just clips of all the bands that we saw and a bit of the venues and a few bits of us popping up and saying hello. So, but you'll get the gist. You'll get to see some moving images from the day too. So look out for that. We'll post when it's available as well. Don't forget that we have also now got a Patreon, which is just £3 a month. And for that, you get to hit all of the bloopers that don't make it into the show. You get 24 hours early access to episodes wherever possible. And you get to find out what's coming up in the following month, which reminds me we need to do that for June.
We do.
So yeah, if you would like to support us on that, we would be very, very grateful indeed. And if you would just like to support us for free, then please give us a like, share, follow, lovely review on wherever you're listening to us. Share all our socials about, tell your friends about us, get people to listen. We would love that very much. And we'll be back again soon with another episode. Make it zombie moon.